Today we have, in the morning, as is on your agenda, we have a set of short presentations on tools. There are many more tools out there than what will be shared this morning, of course. And then after the break, we have this panel on some of the current adaptation strategies being implemented by several of you. Again, that's not everyone. It was just a small sample. Then we have lunch with the same plan as yesterday, so hopefully you still have your sheets. And then in the afternoon, it's generally what is on your agenda. We're going to actually be breaking out by resource area versus goal area. We will explain it. But it's really all focused on developing strategies and next steps. But one thing that we went to note that last night, Larry and Louise took a stab, based on all the conversations yesterday, at crafting some overarching kind of vision language and some language for the main sub or big goals that came out of the work yesterday. This is, you know, just an initial draft, and but very helpful, and many of you were talking about the need for this kind of language. So if there's any of you, they're going to work on it a little bit more at lunch. If there's any of you who would like to be part of a synthesis, a conversation to work on the wordsmithing of this and thinking about any edits that might be needed, can you, and this would be meeting together over today's lunch, can you raise your hand if you're interested in being part of that? And I need to actually write it down. So we've got Scott and Carol.
Sally.
Did anyone else have their hand up? And Juan Carlos. Oh, good, Juan Carlos. I was going to suggest you if you hadn't raised your hand. And James. Okay, so you all will stay here at lunch, and we'll, so as soon as we're ready to break for lunch, come up to the front and we'll check in about it. Okay, so that is all we want to say. Anybody have any questions about the day? Oh, interpreters. Okay, we're good on that count. Okay, so the first person up this morning, and we are all set. We can take that down now. Is Amanda and Mo? Who's going first?
Amanda.
Okay. Amanda has been spending a lot of time working on the website.
Buenos dias. My name is Amanda Webb, and I'm a research specialist with the Desert LCC. We launched our new website a few months ago at desertlcc.org. With help from our partners, we're continuing to develop content and add new science products to the website that are freely available. Today, I want to highlight for you a few features and resources that are available to you through our website and that we will be building on in the months ahead. The first thing I want to show you is how to access information about Desert LCC-funded projects and associated products. So if I hover my mouse here over projects, I see that our projects are already pre-sorted according to two criteria. On the left, by product, such as publication, website, maps, that sort of thing. And on the right, by general category of where the project, what kind of project it is. So for example, if I go to conservation planning, click on that, I'll get several projects as results, and I can scroll down here and read a brief synopsis, and then click on a particular project. And when I do, it takes me to a summary page, including a map. And then if you scroll down to the bottom of the page, this is where we attach products or add a link to a product that is hosted on another website. And so on this example, here's a final report that's available for download. We also have a resources tab. Our webinars here are very popular. I'm also going to show you maps and spatial data. As an example, again, access to maps for printing or even GIS data on this particular project. And all of this is accessible and downloadable for your use. But perhaps searching using the pre-established categories maybe is not that useful to you. And I don't know what that says. Okay, well, that'll work. So let's say that I just want to search according to some sort of a theme. And then I'll get a series of search results that show up all different types, including events, denoted by this calendar symbol here, resources, such as the Archipelago Madrean Archipelago Rapid Ecoregional Assessment. But I want to draw your attention to this first one, which is a link to a web page on our website. And so this is a web page that we're developing specifically for your pilot area. And here we will be creating a web page to support collaboration and communication for partners across the pilot area, as well as just to provide some general information about the area and make it easily accessible to you. So as you can see right now, we just have our announcement for the meeting that we're sitting in right now, but just wanted to give you a heads up that coming soon, we'll have more on here, and so we'll be sending this link to you in the future and providing you with additional updates. So one last thing I just want to point out under resources is that we've also provided a way to get to the Conservation Planning Atlas that Mo is going to tell you about. So go to the resources, and then down at the bottom, there's this big button for the Conservation Planning Atlas. It takes you to a summary page. And then when I click on this link, it should take us to the Conservation Planning Atlas. And there it is. So. Thank you, and I'll pass it over to Mo.
Okay, great. So Amanda showed you one way to get to the CPA. That's what we call the Conservation Planning Atlas. It's another fun acronym. But if you're like me and you forget how to do things all the time, I'm just going to start from scratch in Google, and you can actually just type in desert. You guys are going to have to let me know if I have typos. LCC CPA, and it should come right up. Okay. And so this is the same tool that Amanda just navigated to through the DLCC website. And basically, this is a live tool that's being currently updated, or always being updated and tweaked for user friendliness. By our data manager, Adam Ricks, and he's currently planning a bit of an overhaul of this product, but really what this is developed for is to provide a free, easily accessible gateway to spatial data and information that is applicable to work in the desert LCC. And there's a couple different ways that you can access that information. I'm going to type in Madrean again. That's where the original search term came up. Say I wanted to look for spatial data that was applicable to the transboundary Madrean watersheds pilot area. I'd type in Madrean, and then a couple different things come up. The BLM, Madrean Archipelago REA, resources that Patrick Christ is about to speak to you a little bit more about are accessible via this website. If we go down a little bit more, this is the actual, just the delineation for the pilot area, the final delineation that we all decided upon. So we can actually directly look at this in a map in the CPA. And to do that, we'd click on it. We'd go up to add to new map. And then it'll open a new tab, and it'll actually create a map for you with a base layer in that map. So you already have a readily usable document just by a couple of different clicks. So you don't have to have a license to ArcGIS in order to use this tool. You just need to have access to the internet and a current browser. Ooh, we're going to skip that. But that is one of the really lovely tools in here, is that it will walk you through the process if you've never used the CPA before. So you can see here's the delineation of our pilot area. It's a little bit hard to see. So not only can you access data on this, but you can actually change the symbology. So if we go over here to layers, and if we hit the little arrow over here and go to style, we're going to create a new style. And we're going to turn it from this kind of green to red. Now it'll reload, but it'll be much more visible now. And so you can tweak a little bit depending on the use that you have for this map, and then you can export it. So let's click away our layers tab. And if we click this, it'll save it to a PDF, a PNG, a PowerPoint presentation, whatever you want. So I'll click PDF, but it creates the map with the extent that you've defined on the screen, and then it also creates a little zoom out. Which is basically to give you context. An example of a zoom out, where if you guys have seen the maps that are in the different breakout rooms, and there's one right down here as well, there's a little zoom out in the corner to give you a little bit more context at a different scale. Ooh. Okay, great. Let me see if I can drag this and make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so this is our exported map. So just in like 5 minutes, even less, we made a map of the transboundary Madrean watershed. It showed where on the planet we were looking. It gives lat and long information at the corners of the map. So it's a really quick and fairly easy tool to use if you're looking to make maps and you don't have access to ArcGIS or don't want to use it for any reason. okay, so let's go back to the CPA. That was a really simple example for a data set that's just up here when we search for Madrean. We also have a gallery of the BLM Madrean Archipelago REA. So if we click on this gallery, we can add those to a new map, or we can also download this data directly and put it into a GIS system of our choosing. Let me click on this. And it shows the three different data sets that are available in this gallery. And if we then click on one of these data sets, they're then available for download. Download layer file for our GIS desktop. So this is an ever-developing but really useful tool for getting spatial data quickly. And so if you have any questions about it, feel free to find me and ask me some more questions. But this is out there for you. And again, if you just Google Desert LCC CPA, you'll be brought right to this website. One other important thing to know is that this is readily translatable into Spanish. So just go up to the upper right-hand corner and click the English tab, and you should be able to translate this into, have the browser translate it into Spanish for you. And that's what I've got for you. Are there any questions? Yeah?
Is the boundary map also a GIS layer that you can import
in RGIS? Yeah, so any of the data, so some data sets on here you can't readily download because of permissions, but as long as they're readily available to the public, you should be able to click the link on the data set name, and then there'll be an available, there'll be a choice for you to download that data set onto your desktop. Yes. Yep. Yeah, Sammy. Oh, right then. You need to create a login, but then after that, you're able to download data. That's a problem.
So therefore, because we're updating our website every day, the new streams are being added and people's contributions to it, this may be an issue for other projects as well, Word data,
Okay. So, yeah? So I'll repeat the question. Just so basically you're worried that some of the websites that are, that provide data that the CPA is linked to is not readily updating on the CPA. Okay, they're linked to a copy of the website instead of the live website, which is updated. Jen, do you want to address that? More generally speaking, just for other online databases like that, the CPA can be directly linked to other GIS databases. So when that database is updated, then the CPA is updated as well. So sounds like that's a project-specific problem that will work out. And I just am repeating myself so the recording gets it. Juan Carlos.
I just wanted to say that the platform is based on something called Data Basin, and Data Basin is a lot larger than just the CPA. So that's where you actually create your login account and have access to all these things. There are many tutorials on how to make the best use of all the potential of Data Basin, and there's actually one in Spanish there as well on an introduction to how to use the platform. So people can find what they need.
Other questions?
James has one. One second.
Right. So it's similar to what other people have been talking about, because there are some pretty good national databases like CONAGUA, USGS, etc., and local, you know, EPA. Are you guys going to provide links to those, or?
Eventually, yeah. Each one of them has specific you know, details that you have to address. But the idea is that, yes, a science-based entry will either be linked to it or be directly added for that, and then applicable ones will be added to the CPA. Yeah. Yeah?
Is the vision to utilize the projects that are being done to put them on the database? Is that when you start doing
projects?
Oh, you
mean active analysis that's done through the LCPD and the Desert LCC?
Yeah, I mean, if you start looking at doing projects on private land, I think you need to be cognizant that some private landowners do not want spatial data to be readily available to the public?
I think it depends on the nature of the analysis, right? If it's very large scale, then it is going to be continuous across private and public lands. If it's a specific analysis that's going on private lands, of course, we'd be sensitive to that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Mo. Are you done?
I'm done.
Thank you. All right. So next up, we have Colleen Whitaker from Southwest Decision Resources talking about our partner assessment.
Hello.
Good morning, everyone. Don't forget this. Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to give you a brief update, or perhaps the first time you've heard about a partner assessment project that we at Southwest Decision Resources have been working on for the Desert LCC. Which one do I press? Oh, it's not on. Works so much better when it's on. Okay. So the purpose of this partner assessment is to support partner identification and engagement in the LCPD process, but also the broader DLCC network, and hopefully to identify some areas of overlap and gaps and opportunities for aligning and collaboration of projects. So the planned outcomes for this process are we're working on building a large partner database that spans the whole Desert LCC geography, and then also more detailed partner databases for each pilot area geography. We'll be making geographic maps of where partners are working, the types of programs they're doing, also some social network analysis maps that will be in the pilot areas. And of course, hopefully all of this will lead to some expanded engagement for current partners and new partners, and to better inform the entire LCPD process. So trying to figure out from talking to partners and learning about what they're doing, how we can make the LCPD process most useful and most easy to be implemented in partners' work. So I'll give you a brief overview. We're working on this assessment in two phases. The first phase is, again, that broader partner inventory for the whole desert LCC geography. And then the second phase is kind of digging deeper into the pilot areas, and I'll talk about some of that work that we've done for the Transboundary Madrean, some mapping work, and some focus group work. So the phase one, the broad partner inventory, this is the inventory of partners working on the Desert LCC focal resources, grasslands, streams, and springs in the whole Desert LCC. We have distributed this inventory both in hard copy but primarily online, and many of you have responded to this inventory, so we thank you for that. If you have not, you won't be surprised that we'll give you another opportunity to do so, or maybe you got asked and just forgot. So after today, we'll be sending out an email to everyone just with that link, so if you forgot to do it before or somehow have not been invited, you'll have a chance to provide some responses. So far, over 1,200 people have been invited to participate in this inventory, and 339 people have responded and told us about their work, so we're looking at a 27% response rate so far with that work. We are building the inventory through a snowball approach. So every question of the inventory asks people, who else should we be reaching out to in the desert LCC? And over 90 people have actually suggested people for us to contact, which we have done. They've all been invited to participate. Many have. And so it's continuing to grow. Just a quick look at who is responding so far. So very heavy on the federal agency NGO side, and unfortunately very low on some of the other important sides, such as tribes and landowners. This is partly just a result of where we started out. So the inventory began with the Desert LCC's mailing list at a certain point in time, which was obviously very heavy in federal agencies and NGOs. So we are beginning to see more of the lower respondents actually building up as we go, building through that snowball approach. So where are people working? Again, the inventory is fairly basic, asking people the type of work that they're doing and where they're working. And we've asked people to delineate where they're working by HUC for watershed boundaries. So this map shows the desert LCC boundary in red, and then all of the small purple polygons are those HUC for watershed boundaries. So increasing depth of purple is more partners working on projects in those areas. So you can see those sort of hot spot areas so far, you know, around where we are now and east of here, and then western edge of Arizona along Colorado, and then also some, you know, Big Bend area, and then into Chihuahua as well. So the deepest colors of purple are between 65 and 80 partners working there. So that is fairly significant. So again, this we need, obviously, please, more here. We know there's more happening. This is just what we've collected so far. So digging into that a little bit, in those programs that are mapped there, what kind of resources are people working on? And so you can see there's a pretty nice spread across the desert LCC resources of rivers, grasslands, and springs. However, and quite a lot, over 50% of partners say their work is directly working in the area of climate change. So, interesting. All right. Another thing that we're doing with this information that we're collecting is looking at social network analysis. So this map was created by Julia Sittig, who works with us. And I will have to refer to a few notes because I find it a little bit confusing. So this map is looking at springs practitioners within the desert LCC, so only people who say they work directly with springs, and asking the question, who do you work with most in your work? So the distance between the dots symbolizes the frequency at which practitioners of different organizational types work with one another. So for example, the number of practitioners who work for federal government agencies, federal government agencies, reported working with local governments more time than they reported working with universities. Okay, so the universities are way over here, and local governments are very close to them. So in the Spring practitioners graph, you can see that NGOs seem to be a central organizational type for Spring's practitioners. So in the middle here, having connections to almost all of the other organizational types. So again, we'll continue to use this tool also to dig more into the data and see how people are working together, who they're working with, looking for those kind of central nodes, and then also outliers, trying to learn from that. So those will be some of our next steps with phase one. We are continuing the broad inventory, and again, we'll give you a chance to respond if you haven't. We would like to be a little more targeted now and try and fill some of those gaps, particularly, obviously, folks in Mexico, and then more of some of the affiliation types that we haven't seen a lot of response from yet, tribes and landowners, et cetera. We're working on the best way to share this information back out with the Desert LCC so that partners can really utilize this. So this is not necessarily where we're going, but this is an example from the Cross Watershed Network. How many of you have ever been on the Cross Watershed Network website? Yay! So, you know, this is about connecting watershed practitioners peer-to-peer, find out, you know, who's working on what you're working on, learning from each other. So, you know, perhaps an example that we could follow for what might be useful, a useful way to share this inventory information for the Desert LCC. So phase two, again, is now taking us back down to these tighter lenses of the pilot areas and giving us a chance to kind of dig deeper into those rather than the more high-level inventory that we're doing for the whole geography. So we'll be working... Not great. The methods here will be a little different. We will sort of have follow-up inventory and assessment to have some more pilot-specific questions, but also more actual person-to-person focus groups and interviews to learn from partners in these pilot areas. So I wanted to show you two examples of what we're learning from the Madrean. The first is last year in Tucson in August, and many of you were there. For the LCPD kind of kickoff workshop there, we had a large breakout group focused on the Madrean, which at that time was just a nominated area. And we asked people to do a quick mapping exercise to show us where you're working and what you're working on in the Madrean area. So this is just a quick look at kind of how much information we got from that. So again, the red boundary is Desert LCC. The green boundary is now Transboundary Madrean. And the purple dots are all of the information that was collected at that Tucson workshop. So we collected over 100 projects, and each of those dots has a specific specific information, obviously, about who's working on it, what the project is, but also a short narrative about what the project is, which is really rich. And thank you to Sammy Hammer for making these maps. So digging in then to those dots of what programs and projects people are working on in the Madrean, for that group of people at that workshop, there was a very high amount of folks whose projects were focused on research and restoration, so research being really high. So because we do have that kind of rich background data about what those projects are, we could dig in a little bit to, okay, what kind of research was that? And you can see quite high in wildlife and water, but a wide variety. And again, this is only just over 100 projects, so certainly not a comprehensive view of what's happening in the Madrean, but a good starting picture. So in addition to doing this kind of mapping work with folks, we are going to be doing focus groups, and we have started that. Our first focus group was U.S. land managers, particularly in this area right around Tucson. And we brought the group together to try and find out really how could this big LCPD process really be made useful for their work and something that they could actually use and implement and make their lives easier rather than harder. And so quick view of what we found, land managers wanted ways to assess their current management. Am I doing the right thing and am I doing it in the right place? And is it having the effect that I want it to have or that I think it's having? More opportunities for shared learning, recognizing that it's always difficult to find the time for these busy practitioners to kind of come together and stay up not only on the latest science, but on what all their partners are doing. So ways to do that more effectively are wanted. This one was interesting, a way to raise the profile of the Madrean Sky Island area, and I think, you know, that's very relevant to what we're doing here today, recognizing that, you know, outside of this area and even inside this area, people don't know what the Madrean area is, never heard the term Sky Islands, and, you know, a kind of labeling and making it more iconic could be helpful for many things, including funding. And then toolbox, obviously, of adaptation strategies that could be used in their areas. Big focus on the ground outcomes and projects, so, you know, not just more planning, but stuff actually happening. And really, they would like an efficient way to prioritize actions and locations for maximum collective impact. So what should I be doing and where is the best place to be doing it so that it's, you know, leading to a greater impact over the full landscape? So as I said, those are kind of just beginning to roll, those focus groups. So we do plan to do many more in the Madrean area. We'd like to do some with non-governmental organizations and partners, and then there are many existing place-based collaboratives working in the area, and so speaking to them as well to see what this process could do from their point of view is part of our plan, and then feeding it all back into the LCPD process to hopefully make it more useful and tangible and realistic for people. That's all.
Questions or comments? Okay.
Down to about 10 minutes each, but my understanding is if there's some follow-up interest, a subgroup can get together offline and go into these in some more detail. So let me just go ahead and move on through and get this to advance. So just to summarize quickly some of the work done on the RIA, and just to acknowledge Sky Island Alliance was one of our key partners on this. So there is a final report in terms of many volumes. It's quite extensive. All of the source data that we collected and used is available, and all of this is through BLM's RIA portal. So all the derived data, so basically the outputs of what we did, we had to deliver working models. That's primarily from the VISTA decision support system, which I'll talk about more later, and then some other materials. So just to quickly summarize the assessments that were actually done, CE stands for conservation elements, and I'll show the lists of those shortly. So the status assessments of how those are doing currently, an ecoregion-wide integrity assessment, some special assessments for the year 2025, so what might happen in terms of status and risk, restoration potential for mesquite invaded uplands, soil erosion potential, an awful lot of climate trend assessments, and that coupled with bioclimate envelope models for four of the conservation elements. So speaking of those, here is the list of terrestrial systems. So I won't read all through these, but we've got valley uplands and montane uplands. There were aquatic systems assessed. So again, getting into some different types of things like playas and riparian and streams and things like that. And then this group of species, mostly mammals, but some examples of some other taxa. Just leave that up for a second. And then just graphically, how the status assessments work. Again, we have our conservation elements. Here we have what in real lingo is called change agents, so things like invasives, wildfire, developments. These are combined through cumulative effects models to then derive these maps of what the condition of their distributions might look like. All right, so for each conservation element, we delivered a conceptual model with these different key ecological attributes and indicators. Literature, there's a distribution map. There is a 30-meter raster status assessment result for each of the indicators, so typically 3 to 5 per element. And then a full status assessment that combines all of those together. And then results at a reporting unit, which was a 4x4 kilometer grid for terrestrial elements or fifth level hawk watersheds for the aquatic elements. So I'm just going to show you a tiny sample of the results, just to give you an idea what these things look like. So this is for the grassland type. We've got status goes from yellow, very, very poor, to dark blue, very, very good. So this is what status would look like for this desert grassland and steppe system, just based on the development change agents. Then we can see what it looks like with fire regime departure. So kind of a mid to high status, and then this is with invasives. And then we combine all those together, so this is 30 meters, so you can see when we combine these together, we get a much lower view of status for grasslands. And then this is the 4x4 kilometer reporting unit result of that, so averaging status by those. As well, there's quantitative outputs as well that are in the reports. All right, climate assessment. What was done for that was a recent climate trend, a future climate for mid-century, and bioclimatic envelope models. So we had monthly maximum temperature change and anomalies from historic monthly minimum temperature change and anomalies, monthly precipitation change and anomalies, and then some other assessments like the change in frost-free days and climate moisture deficit. So just again, quick example, this is minimum temperature. This is comparing this historic 1901 to 1980 versus mid-century. And the scale is number of standard deviations. So you can see these very darkest colors are expected to be upwards of 5 standard deviations hotter than the historic for August, for example. Okay. This is precipitation, looking at future anomaly. So both in terms of a couple standard deviations drier, as well as wetter compared to historic. And then just an example of one of these bioclimate envelope models, and this compared the current climate suitability to where future climate's going to be. And so the green is where we have overlap. You can think of that as refugia. The blue is where we're expected to have contraction in adapted climate for, again, grassland steppe type. And then yellow is potential expansion, but just, again, based on climate variables only. But you can see these were done for essentially the whole range of the type. So it goes well outside the project area. And then some special assessments like solar potential, really just bringing together data that had already been developed. And then the potential for restoration of mesquite invaded uplands. And this one is showing yellow would be not suitable. Again, all the details on how we came up with suitability are all in the report. So yellow, not suitable. Green, moderately suitable. Blue, highly suitable. All right, so let me take the rest of the time just to talk a quick bit about NatureServe Vista. So this is just indicating this is software. It doesn't come with data already loaded, so you can use it on the land, in the water, anywhere on the planet. And it's been used for a large variety of activities, and it's had over $4 million invested in it, and we have an endowment for it to keep it supported. So this is an ArcGIS extension. The tool is useful in a lot of different types of planning and management activities, usable by different skill levels with proper support. We do provide help built within it, so there's a big manual built within the tool, as well as we offer available tech support training and other kinds of assistance. And we've had a couple thousand downloads to the tool since its first release back in 2004. I'm not going to go all through these questions, but just use this to highlight the different components of VISTA. So this term conservation elements is the same term that RIAs used. So again, the things that you're interested in assessing impacts upon them and representing them into the future. There are scenarios, as many as you want. So these are the patterns of land use, conservation, management, stressors, and so on that can affect your elements. And then we have evaluations of our elements and scenarios together to understand how are the elements doing now and under different scenarios, where should I act and what should I do. So what does VISTA help you do? We didn't really invent this out of nothing. It's designed to apply well-established concepts, in particular for what you guys are interested in, systematic conservation planning. In other words, landscape conservation design. I'll talk about that more in a bit. And a variety of these other things like cumulative effects assessment. You can support complete life cycle planning. So doing scenario-based assessments, like we did in the RIAs, then moving on to develop alternatives, implementing a plan, monitoring your plan, and conducting adaptive management. And I'll explain more how that works shortly. And then you can work at multiple scales, which is fairly unique among decision support tools. Most of them have you, like Mark Sanford, for example, have you intersect all of your data to a single grid, and then you're stuck with that unless you start over. VISTA lets you maintain all your data at its source resolution, so you can move back and forth among scales like regions to sites and then back again. And you can work in any environment, although you guys are pretty much set in your desert and grassland environment. So just a quick example with some thumbnails about what VISTA is really doing. So we have our elements in terms of distribution maps, values about them, and in particular, this is an expert knowledge-driven tool, and I know that's part of the process you're doing is deriving a lot of that expert knowledge. So that all goes into the database. We can take that information, and we can do overlays of it to derive a lot of different what we call conservation value summaries or different weighted overlays to understand patterns of value across the landscape. You can then define your scenarios as many as you want. We usually start off with a current actual baseline, which we did in the RIA. There can then be something like a build-out. In that case, we had a 2025 expected development scenario. And then you can have other trends, so trends in fire, invasives, climate, as well as developing your alternatives or other people's alternatives. And then finally, your own plan as a scenario that you're monitoring implementation of it. And so scenarios are physically what's going on in the land, air, and water. And then what are the mechanisms behind those things? VISTA is then going to intersect your elements with your scenarios and apply a couple of different cumulative effects assessment models. So you get a whole slew of maps of how each of your conservation elements fared under the scenario, as well as some synthetic maps across those things. And then you get quantitative reports of how each of the elements did under that scenario. You can then examine what's going on in each location of your region and understand how the elements are performing within that area and what particular particularly are causing the stressors on it, and then turn this into a either site mitigation tool or a whole complete plan development tool to aid you in avoiding the whack-a-mole problem and working over large regions. We have a wizard to work with Mark Sand, and hopefully soon with Zonation as well. So you can develop these reserve networks and then bring those into Vista and make them more realistic and practical and hone the spatial design of those. And then again, bring that in as a scenario to test it with the features you can't change and ensure its ecological viability. And then you can go into your adaptive management cycle where anytime you can bring in new or updated inputs, you can address new and emerging threats and opportunities and so on, and use the tool throughout that cycle to continue to reach your conservation objectives over time. So just a few screenshots from the Madre, and I'll just point out while this stops at the border, this project can be extended into the rest of the area that you're interested in working on. You just need to add the data for it. This is an adaptation we did for Fort Huachuca, so that's why I'm focusing on that, where we added some additional rare and imperiled species. So just zooming in, this is a map of the original rattlesnake after the Vista model for condition has been applied. So green, good, red, bad. This is the base footprint. Again, you get detailed reports on these things, and so I can see for the rattlesnake's model distribution, only 22% of it is expected to be viable under our current scenario. And then I can zoom in to a place. This was just a set of grid units, but they can be any polygons you want. And I can see how each of these rare and imperiled species is performing within those set of sites. And for rattlesnake, for example, the light green is how is the amount of compatible or viable area throughout the whole project planning area. The light red is the incompatible. The dark green and dark red are the compatible area and incompatible area within that particular site. So we can start to get a sense of the irreplaceability of any particular site within our planning region to meet the objectives for any conservation element. And we can understand what are the stressors acting on our conservation element, how it's responding to any individual stressor that we might select. And then this is where we would propose an action, some kind of a conservation action, as well as we can propose an implementation mechanism to actually carry it out and then save that out into a shapefile and start to build our landscape conservation design that way. So speaking of that, this is my last slide. Is again, we can use Vista for multiple scale conservation planning. And it's very flexible as to the available inputs you have. I know that we definitely have differences in available inputs on each side of the border. We can assess landscape scale problems for action, do prioritization then via Marksan. We can refine that prioritization for driving actual landscape design, getting at ecological viability, efficiency, practicality, connectivity, and so on, things that are not well handled in Marksan. We can readily step down those results to the implementation level and then support that adaptive management. So I will go ahead and conclude there. I don't know if we have time for questions, but if we do, I'm happy to take any. Otherwise, I just have a couple follow-up points of contact there for you. So thanks.
Thanks, Patrick. So stay there. Questions? Gita, and raise your hand if you somebody else, and then Larry Stevens. Hi. I had a question about accuracy assessments and sort of reliability evaluations of some of the data that went into the REAs and the models that are coming out of it. I've spent a fair amount of time digging into them. I really appreciate and impressed with the amount of work that's gone into them, and in the interest of making the best use of those data sets and those products, I think a lot comes down to having easy access to being able to distinguish between the models that really do represent reality and the models that or data that for one reason or another just miss the mark. And it's recognizing how hard it is to get these things right. There's an effort among this whole group to improve, to recognize data gaps and fill data gaps. But what's the, so I want to ask you, what are the most direct ways when using the REA data to get information on that accuracy and reliability of each piece of the data so that we can get the best results out of using them?
Yeah, you really need to have to go to the metadata for those source inputs. And then for each of the outputs that we derived, there's, of course, information about limitations within our modeling process itself. And then those are going to, you know, be incorporated with limitations within the source data. Now in the report, and you have to really go into all of those volumes, there's a lot of detail there. We did try to get very specific about limitations as we understood them of each of the inputs that went in. But as you said, I mean, there's hundreds and hundreds of inputs and outputs for this thing. And so, you know, that's the best answer I can give you. You really have to dig into each of those. And then part of it naturally would be, you know, expertise from within the region that's going to have the best idea of just looking at some of those things to see if they make sense. Now, when we did the models of status assessment within VISTA, we did hold a series of workshops and web meetings with people that you know, we recruited and volunteered to actually participate in those to identify for us, you know, when things looked a little wonky. And we did get feedback on those, and those led to typically corrections in the model parameters, which we probably don't have time to go into, but again, that's all detailed in the report, as well as in the VISTA guidebook as to how that modeling actually works in some of the site impact settings and offsite effects. I think we actually ended up dropping offsite effects because people did not feel confident in the ability to set those things. But that is an option in the tool.
This is Larry Stevens. Thank you for that really excellent presentation. This is like many of the DLCC programs. This is just a really incredibly productive tool for as many applications. And I hope to interact with you on some questions I have about Springs. But the question for you is a little more basic. How did you handle the development component of your mapping? And is that based on census data or on development, developed lands area change in the U.S., and how did that differ between the U.S. and Mexico?
So we didn't include any of Mexico. There was discussion early on about strong desire all around to actually include Mexico. But, you know, it's essentially, you know, BLM was able to fund work on their side of the border and not on the other side. So that was a key limitation. So it'll be exciting, you know, through the landscape conservation cooperative work to see if that can be extended and continued on. So in terms of development, again, I'm kind of going back about 4 years now in my memory. And it was a big team effort, so I wasn't intimately involved in every piece of the data, but we gathered from a lot of different sources, and again, those are all detailed in the report. A lot of it were sources of information that BLM had already collected at the, you know, level of the National Operations Center, as well as at the Arizona, New Mexico State Office levels. It's possible we even got some data from field office, but I'm not sure on that. So a lot of that represented the current development. And then for the future, the decision was to rely on projects that were already in the approval pipeline, to the sense that these were projects with fairly high confidence of actually getting put in the ground within the next 15 years or so, or basically at this point now going to 2025. So other RIAs we worked on took a little more expansive view, and we brought in model data from EPA on potential urbanization and exurban development out over a longer time frame. But again, this particular RIA that was driven by an advisory committee, as they all were, they wanted to be a little bit more conservative on it and feel like that 2025 represented fairly high confidence development.
Okay, great. Last question, Carol. That was an easy one. It was just to make your contact info visible. Okay, thank you so much, Patrick.
Sure, and again, if there's interest in a follow-up, we could do a longer live demo with Vista and answer questions about how that project might be leveraged for the monitoring LCD work. But thanks again for the time.
Before you sign off, raise your hands if you would be interested in a longer live demo as he's offering. Okay, we've got probably at least 30.
Okay, no worries.
Okay, we'll work on scheduling that.
Okay, terrific.
Thanks.
All right, thanks. Bye, okay. Everyone.
Last but not least is Mo Carell talking about data.
Okay, I'm just going to close that, Patrick.
And while they're doing that, did anybody misplace their beautiful silver pen that says Goldman Environmental Prize? Oh, okay.
I know, I'm trying to quit.
So we're just going to have, Mo will talk for 5 or 6 minutes, I think, and hope, or not even, and then we're going to be ready for our 10:15 break.
Okay, so one thing that we've been doing while you guys have been watching is trying to follow the speaker with a camera, and for people who walk around a lot, it's kind of a fun thing to do blind because you can't see the camera when the speaker is moving around and presenting, so that's what we were setting up. I'm going to zoom through a very condensed version of the webinar that we gave last week, Louise, Tani, and myself, as well as Colleen was on there, categorizing some of the data that you all sent me. I sent out a call for data that was applicable to the Transboundary Madrean Watersheds pilot area, and you all responded with a bunch of different types of data and work that had already been done in this area. Ooh. Okay. So generally speaking, that data was split into a couple different categories. Landscape scale resources, general databases for grasslands, springs, and streams. Of course, the rapid ecoregional assessments, or the REA, that Patrick just talked to us about. And then camera databases stuck out as a particular type of data that a lot of people from varied backgrounds were collecting. So first, the vegetation mapping tool. This is something that Miguel Pavon, who is a subcontractor through Bird Conservancy of the Rockies, is working on. He's working on an open source tool to classify vegetative cover within a predefined area. So right now, this isn't actually an existing layer. It's an open source tool that's being developed for use on an area that you're interested in doing work in. So this should be ready in November of 2016, this year, just in a couple months. Oh, gosh. And when that's available, he'll be putting on a webinar both in English and in Spanish to instruct people how to use this tool. We also have, I think it's a really exciting opportunity to use time series analysis through Landsat imagery in Google Earth Engine. We have some people at the Colorado Plateau Research Station in the USGS already working on this. And it basically allows you to define an area of interest and look at change in reflectance values from satellite imagery over time. You can choose to analyze those reflectance values in a bunch of different ways, again, depending on the question that you'd like to ask. But because of the recent advances in computing power due to Google Earth Engine, we have the ability to ask really large-scale questions of this data set. And for those of you not familiar with Landsat imagery, it's a 30 by 30 meter resolution imagery that's collected via satellite every 16 days and is freely available to the public, all pre-processed roughly 24 hours after the satellite goes over your area of interest. So this is a really potentially powerful data source. Those at the Colorado Plateau Research Institute, or let's see, Research Station, excuse me, have done a couple different analyses, and I have them examples of them for you here. This is of the Chihuahuan Desert, so they defined an area of extent around the Chihuahuan Desert, and then calculated the standardized precipitation and evapotranspiration index, which is basically a measure of drought across a landscape. And as you can see, they started in 1980, where the Landsat data really starts to be usable in these types of time series analyses. And so drought increases, moisture goes down over time. We know that this happens, but this is a quantitative way of showing it, again, within your area of interest. This is another example, again, from outside the our pilot area extent. However, I think it's fairly usable. And again, you can decide your area of extent and then apply this tool both in the U.S. and Mexico parts of the pilot area. And this example, they chose to look at cheatgrass expansion. So this is for 2003. And you can see basically the changes in red show cheatgrass expanding over their area of interest over just a couple of years using this analysis tool. So that's available, and I'm happy to speak more about this tool. This is fairly new, but Aaron Bunting is the contact for this work at the research station. Of course, we also have our key resource databases, and these have been ongoing projects that have been helped along by the Desert LCC. For grasslands, we have a geospatial data inventory, which we are wrapping up right now at Bird Conservancy of the Rockies. The Spring Stewardship Institute has Springs Online, which is their online database that we talked about in our earlier discussion on the CPA, but allows querying of locations of springs across the Desert LCC and a larger extent, if I understand. It's outside the Desert LCC, too, as well. Yeah. And finally, the Desert Flows database, which is a record of streams as well as a catalog of information and previous work done on streams, again, within the larger DLCC area, and that's available for use as well through the Water Water Resource Research Center at the University of Arizona. Again, Patrick just talked to us about the rapid ecoregional assessments. This is the extent for the Madrean Archipelago REA, but there have been other REAs done in other parts of the Desert LCC. So for this pilot area, this is the REA that it's applicable to our analyses. But if you're interested in doing other analyses in other parts of the DLCC or looking at data from those areas, there are other REAs available or in process. Now, as Patrick just reviewed, we had conservation elements, so species distributions or species assemblage distributions. They also have mapped ecosystem areas that they all refer to as conservation elements. Also, they've mapped change agents across the area of interest, so fire, heat, and drought. And they combine these into a series of response models and integrity assessments. And this is what some of the output for the REAs looks like. Camera databases, again, as I mentioned, were probably the most commonly referred resource to me and probably from the most varied backgrounds. And I really think this is kind of an opportunity for people that have very potentially different interests to be collecting very similar data types. Saguaro National Park has a camera database, as well as Arizona State University, the Coalition for Sonoran Desert Protection, and the Arizona Desert Bighorn Sheep Society. We also have a lot of U.S. federal agencies that are collecting data, and as is true of a lot of our data sets, we are data poor in Mexico. So if you are aware of camera databases or projects that are ongoing in Mexico, I'd really love to know about them. This is just some fun pictures from game cameras. And it kind of shows up here, really, they're coming from a bunch of different sources. So Roadrunner. Sheepies. And then outside of the data sources that I've outlined for you, there's a lot of spatial data clearinghouses and repositories. I was also sent a lot of species-specific information, so species distribution information. And unfortunately, if I did a presentation on all of the data that got sent to me, it would take hours and everybody would probably be asleep. But I really want to thank you all for sending all of that data my way. And after this meeting, after we've kind of honed some of our conservation goals and objectives, I'll be able to use some of the data that you've sent to me and also sent out a data call for that's a little bit more specific. So I'm going to actually skip way ahead to the end of the meeting and just ask if there's any questions about that data that I just described to you. And also, if you have camera projects, please let me know about them. That's my email address. And I'm also on the DLCC website or the Bird Conservancy website, or you can talk to me directly. Are there any questions?
Okay. If you think of one, you can catch her in the break, which is what we're going to do now. So please give a round of applause for all the presenters of the morning. And the break is over on that side. Hopefully both coffee pots are pretty full. Again, the cafe down the way is also available. You have till 10:30. Thank you. Hello all. Please take your seats. We are about to take off. And please put on your seatbelts, because this presentation is going to blow you away. Okay, so we have the one and only Carolyn Enquist. For a short presentation about scenario planning, and then I'll tell you what's happening after that.
People can hear me? All right. Well, great. Thank you to the organizers and the Desert LCC for inviting me into this process and being able to sort of contribute to this piece in particular of the process that we're all going through. So what I'm going to do, like Tawny said, is just give kind of a brief overview of this. But first I'll introduce myself and say that I'm from the Southwest Climate Science Center. The Southwest is Science Center is part of a whole network. We're one of eight climate science centers around the nation. We are at the Department of Interior level, but USGS provides sort of the oversight for our center. And here at the Southwest, we are based at the University of Arizona and are hosted by the Institute of the Environment that's on the top floor of this building. All right, so without further ado, I'll give you a quick little overview, and I just have to say that after this morning's conversations and panels, this is sort of, it was a great segue, because a lot of you have thought about climate change, have maybe engaged in a scenario planning process. And so some of what I'm going to cover might be a little bit redundant, a little elementary. But I am going to stay at kind of a high level just to kind of get people on the same page as we move forward in thinking about scenario planning over the next many months. So I'll just do a quick review about what we know about climate change in this region. That will be followed by a little bit, well, what don't we know? And then moving into the scenario planning piece, I'll give a little description of that and make a plug for why I think we need it, and maybe some of you already are there. And then ultimately, what do we expect as a group to get out of this process? That was weird. So first, this is just kind of a little cartoon that we generated recently, thanks to Christine Schirmer, who's our program manager, for putting this together. Basically, what we're looking at is a little cartoon of impacts that we've seen across the Southwest region. Many of you are familiar with these things. The colors in the background represent this sort of long, sort of persistent drought, with the purple being extreme drought starting, say, in the mid-2000s, and then with kind of the movement of some of that extreme to California and the environs more recently. So we're looking at about 15 years of persistent drought in our region. Specific impacts include the warming temperatures, of course, that lead to reduced snowpack and decreased flows in many of our major perennial rivers, to these large unprecedented wildfires. We've seen a lot of those in our state of Arizona in the Southwest, and then, of course, California. Is experiencing a lot of what we've experienced already. Of course, coastal flooding, as well as flooding after extreme storm or precipitation events across the region. And then this widespread forest dieback that really started with quite a punch in the Four Corners area in the mid-2000s, that has spread. California now has at least 25 million dead trees that they're dealing with, and we're seeing that in the Madrean region as well. So this has kind of led to this idea recently in the literature of this sort of emergent era of mega disturbance. And this paper specifically referred to forests, but you really could start applying this to sort of many other sort of ecosystem types and sort of taken sort of collectively this idea of mega disturbance, all of this kind of culminating and coming together. So what are some of those things? So we all are familiar with these impacts such as unprecedented drought, more intense storms, more severe floods that lead to erosion, removal of soil from our systems, bigger fires, more insect outbreaks, forest dieback, and then you combine that with the land use and degradation that has taken place in many of our areas that we work in, and you throw in some invasive species, pollution, etc. So that's what we mean by all taken together, this sort of mega disturbance concept. And when you bring these things together collectively, we're starting to experience this large-scale ecosystem change or transformation. And I think probably many of you are starting to kind of see that on the ground as well. So what does that mean for the ecosystems then that we're trying to manage? A lot of folks are sort of talking about this concept nowadays, novel ecosystems, novel assemblages of species, things that we haven't really seen together before, and it really kind of makes us think about our concept of invasive species. Someone was talking about that this morning. And what do we manage for? Or what do we even try to adapt to? Those are a lot of, you know, kind of tricky questions that we're all sort of asking ourselves. And so this is kind of, we're moving into the realm of what we really still are grappling with, what we don't know. And I've had these conversations with many of you out there for years now, it seems like. And, you know, we're still trying to get our head around this. These questions, what does this mean? How do we cope with this? All this added uncertainty and complexity? Will what we do right now really be enough? So what's next? So we're kind of left with this situation that we're all kind of, we're sort of all in this high uncertainty, high complexity situation. And this is where I'll move into this idea of scenario planning, which again, a lot of you have already started to kind of play around with. Scenario planning is really well situated to kind of help us kind of break down some of these barriers, maybe even some of this paralysis that we might experience when we're in this high uncertainty and high complexity situation. So, what is it? Here's a definition. And I'm specifically talking here about how we're applying it to natural resource management and conservation. Certainly people use this in all sectors, business, utilities, across many sectors, people are using this technique. And it's really, again, a great process to inform decision-making under uncertainty. And increasingly, as many of you know, it's been being used in terms of climate change and adaptation work. This can be, you can take a lot of different approaches to this. It can be very much a researcher-driven place. You know, people here at the university might, like, you know, dive down and then later just kind of say, here, managers, here are your scenarios. Here's what you should do. Or it could be very much the reverse. And it could be very expert-driven and people just sitting around a table putting their heads together, trying to come up with some what-ifs and playing around with scenarios from that way. Scenarios can also themselves, so I was talking about scenario planning as a process, but generating the actual scenarios or stories themselves can be derived from a variety of processes. They can be through models, forecasts, again, some of this projection sort of based stuff that's very exploratory. Or you can start with something called backcasting. So you have a desired future condition, and then you work backwards, kind of like in a logic model. So some newer work is realizing, you know, kind of looking at all the instances that this has been done in, this kind of exploratory versus normative, that's the backcasting, versus expert-driven or researcher-driven or more participatory in nature, and realizing that you know, there's a lot of room to bring these together, this research-based to and practice-based stuff, and that this sort of mid-area, and this is a coming out of paper that it's in publication right now or in press right now, this is a really kind of new area for us to make a lot of progress in. So it really is kind of a very collaborative, both expert and research-driven process. But it starts from the beginning and works all the way through. So as you might imagine, we're hoping to do that sort of process with this group. So why would we need it? So this idea of longer term strategies, kind of thinking through the lens of ecosystem transformation, novel ecosystems, et cetera, beginning to identify these longer term strategies. Also to think more systematically about many of our critical uncertainties. And we went through a process yesterday, thank you for many of you who filled out those forms when you were exhausted at the end of the day. But I picked out a few real kind of interesting ones. So an uncertainty might relate to the timing and frequency of flows, and particularly after extreme events, and how then that affects stream ecosystems, et cetera, to how do we deal with habitat shifts and restoration? Do we need to be thinking about restoration a little bit differently? You know, is it worth some of the investment that we're making in it? Can we be a little bit more strategic about how we do that? And then that sort of goes to this sort of prioritization of how we then make these investments. We all have limited time, limited staff, limited money. And so how do we then go about making decisions with this uncertainty? So those are some of the critical uncertainties that came out yesterday, and those are great questions that I think will feed really nicely into this process. And then also, by going through a process like this, we can't even predict what might come out of it. So this is something that we might be able to come up with some new innovations and opportunities that really help us then cultivate the relationships and collaborations that we're entering into. So here's just a quick cartoon of how then we might begin this process. And again, as I mentioned, it's sort of a mixed approach where we take researchers as well as experts and people on the ground to sort of put together these different pieces, these various components of what can go into a scenario, climate, hydrology, so the biophysical, but then the social, the political, the regulatory, as well as economic dimensions. And then our conservation and management priorities. Pull in critical uncertainties with desired future outcomes. And that then, that process leads us to coming up with a suite of what we might call plausible scenarios. So it's not just climate scenario, it's not just a biology or ecology scenario, or whatever the other, but we bring these things together to come up with these plausible situations by which we, that informs, again, the long-term strategies that we're hoping to identify. Expected outcomes of this then, again, long-term strategies are actually actionable in the face of climate change, so perhaps strategies that are responsive to multiple scenarios or robust to multiple scenarios. And then ultimately prioritizing some of these long-term actions through a decision-making process, such as structured decision-making or other decision analysis process. And then, again, we hope to get closer to achieving our conservation and management goals by going through this. A quick little cartoon would be, again, we take the suite of plausible scenarios. Hopefully that leads us to some long-term strategies, prioritizing actions on the ground so that we can get to, again, this climate smart, if you will, conservation and management goals. Some resources that we'll be using through this process. This is a really great one from Fish and Wildlife Service, Erica Rowland et al. And then this is one that I referenced a little earlier, this STAR et al. This came out of a working group that we've been having here at the university. And all of this, again, is so that we're not caught flat-footed and so that we're not caught just responding or reacting to a situation, that we're being more anticipatory and proactive. And frankly, to avoid maladaptation. This is supposed to be a movie. I couldn't get it to work, but this is a polar bear shaving. I guess, trying to probably not adapt in the best way possible. So at any rate, I'm going to stop there and hand it off to Tani. I don't know if we have questions.
Questions?
All right, crickets. All right, that works. Yeah, what now? Yeah, what's going to happen? That's what we're going to figure out together. All right, thank you.
But as Carolyn said, this is about having the scenario planning reflect what's actually coming out of this process. So not presenting all the scenarios finished today, but having today this workshop inform what they do, and then they'll bring it back. Thank you, Carolyn. Okay. So, the next thing, the last big thing we're doing is, we're calling it strategic actions. So basically, the plan is, we're dividing into some working groups, as before. Right now, based on how it went yesterday, we're thinking that streams, springs, grasslands, there's very tangible interests in those. So we want to have those three, and we want to have another couple, but we're going to, based on what came out yesterday, and we're going to do a show of hands so we can see what groups you're going to actually choose to go to. And then what we're going to do is basically we have some team of people worked overnight or worked in the evening to type up the high priority stressors from yesterday by resource group, and typed up the summary, the synthesis of all that overarching goal work that was biodiversity, and then there's these subheaders of fundamental objectives. That's going to be a handout too. So you get the fruits of yesterday's labor. And that is source material for what you do today, because we keep wanting to build on what we've already done, right? So basically, you're going to be coming up with a set of high priority strategic actions to further that goal area and deal with the big stressors. And then on a subset of those is what we're going to actually do action planning on, so we can come out with teams of people that want to, that have some steps and plans already started to get together and move on implementation. So that is, in a nutshell, the actual steps the facilitators will walk you through. But in terms of which are how we're going to break up. So we have the three springs, streams, grasslands. The others that came up, one was, did you want to say something, Louise? Okay. So one is elevational. So obviously Sky Islands have montane that we don't want to forget about. So this was, there is montane and there's like really low areas like playas. So one question for you is, and then I'll tell you the last one is stakeholder and community engagement and collaboration, which is kind of a little bit different, but it would be really good to have a small group that was talking about some of those strategies. So if you were, if you were going to pick one of those groups, and if you were going to pick not spring, streams, grasslands, or collaboration, and you're in that elevational, this is the, we did not agree in our team. Is it a lowlands group and a really highlands group, or is it a elevational that includes both? Do you understand my question? Would you, if you were, do you want to go, is there anybody here who would choose to be in a playas only group? Raise your hand. Is there anybody here that would choose to be in a montane group? Two. Is there anybody who would choose to be in a kind of this elevational gradient type of group that includes montane? So the montane people didn't raise their hands again. Well, maybe there's not enough people that would choose that. You saw eight? Let's try it again. If you would be in an elevational group from the lowest to the highest, raise your hands. Hi. One, two, three, four, five. Oh, you have a question. Elevational. That's the proposal. And then the fifth one, that would be fourth. Well, there's a lot of you, right? So we're trying to also not have humongous groups. Well, it cross cuts. And then we would consolidate where there's some overlap, right? And then the fifth one would be stakeholder and community engagement collaboration, which is how to do that in this process. Citizen science, all the stuff that has come up and got kind of mentioned in all the groups. So how many of you would choose that to be in a more of a collaboration group? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, a number of you.
Can I make a comment on that?
Yes.
Concerns about taking collaboration and the social piece outside of the context of the resource itself?
I know. It's cross-cutting. I mean, everything is cross-cutting. That's the challenge of this whole thing. But I agree. But it is a way, we're going to have to then synthesize across it. Because but if you don't talk about it more explicitly, those groups might focus so much on, you know, doing more mesquite treatments or whatever it is that's more substantive. Well, everybody talk about it, and if you want to join a separate group, which I will be in, we have ourselves all divvied up. So now please just raise your hand one time, about you're going to choose between grasslands, streams, springs, elevational gradient, multi-elevation, whatever you call it, and engagement, in knowing that there's going to be overlap, and we'll sort it out. So if you're going to raise your hand one time, let's start out with, Mo, you're helping count, please. Grasslands. Oh, perfect size. Streams. About 11. Springs. One. And don't raise your hand twice. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. About 9. Okay. Elevational gradient. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's a group. And engagement, collaboration. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's like really lovely. Okay, but as Jenny said, everybody try to deal with the engagement. And it is one of the questions you're going to be talking about when you, after you generate your strategies and there's some criteria for prioritizing, then you're going to look at what partners are already working on this and who might be co-leads for it. Who else needs to be involved? And that's where you can get at collaboration. What are immediate opportunities to implement it or integrate it into an existing effort? Where should it happen? What are some next steps and key milestones? How will we measure progress? And do you anticipate progress and or lessons to share with this group in 1 year? So that's your instructions for action planning on a subset, a few that you as a group say, these are the ones we want to really move forward with right away. Okay, so we're going to have the streams group here in this room. And grasslands and collaboration are going to be in room 225. Springs and elevational gradient, and you're welcome to rename yourselves when you get there, are going to be in 215. And you're going to take a rolling break. Whenever your group decides you want to take a break, you're going to have your 15 minutes at a nice breaking point. And you're going to have until 4, and then we're going to all come back to this room. So you should have enough time to really talk through it and not feel so rushed. Any questions or comments? Elise? Yes. Streams here in the front. Grasslands, room 225. Collaboration or engagement, room 225. Springs, 215. Elevational gradient, 215. And Jenny has one thing to say.
Did you have a question based on? Okay. So the Sonoran Joint Venture, for the past couple of years, we've been going through this conservation action planning process using the open standards for the practice of conservation. And our region, the Sonoran Joint Venture is divided up into 4 different regions, one of which is encompassed by this LCPD area. And so I brought some, just one page printouts of the biggest priorities that our management board and technical team have identified. These are vetted. We have, you can see our conservation targets on the front, our broad, our long-term ecological goals for the region, the highest threats, so very high and high threats, if you're familiar with the open standards process. And then the part that I think has the most relevance here is this section. We have identified a list of strategies, with the exception of the final bullet. Please just take a pencil and draw a line through that. That shouldn't be there. But these are strategies that we have gone through. We have rated them. They have all been evaluated by people working in the region as effective strategies for addressing the threats or conservation challenges within this geography. So there are also Carol Beardmore is our science coordinator, Thais Sapli, Sally Heil, are you still here? She's on our management board. Sergio Avila is on the management board. They've been all, Louise is on the management board. They've been involved in this, probably other people here that I'm leaving out, I'm sorry. But they can talk to you more about this. And I have more copies up in room 225. And I'll grab them. I don't think I have enough for everybody, but I certainly have enough for multiple copies for each group. Long story short, it would be fantastic if our if some of these strategies that have been vetted by people working in the region already and identified as priorities could fit into this process. It would be fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, and on that note, and just a second, Carol, is this is about realistic strategies, existing strategies that you are already working on or could be working on, and aligning that and building on all of the good work that's already going on so that more can actually be done and happen. And Carol.
I was wanting to ask you if you have those Slavsky's nomenclature for threats, that handout that I gave you guys yesterday. Oh, you ended up with them? Okay, so we're gonna give those to a few people in each group, because not only does he have a nomenclature, a lexicon for the threats, but he also has the lexicon for actions too. So kind of, it'll give you a place to start to be thinking about what his list is.
Okay, any other questions? So please go to your respective rooms, and may the force be with you.